I'm Coco Novak, author, show host, and public speaker. Welcome to season two of The Coco Novak Show. In this season, we're going to delve deep into what makes us human, relationships, stories of failure that we learn from, and stories of success. It's going to be real, raw, and relatable. So stay tuned, hit that subscribe button, and enjoy. Hector, welcome to Tuesday Talks.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thanks. Love that you came over. And you are the first guest in Series 2, starting in September.
Loving it. I'm feeling very chuffed to be the first one.
Awesome. Glad you are. So you're a fashion designer. So we're going to talk a little bit about fashion today, which I'm very excited about. You have your own brand. You're also a photographer.
I am.
You're a scout, fashion scout.
I run a model scouting company as well. Yeah.
How exciting.
Yeah. Can be.
You're also Christian. We're going to talk about that as well.
I am.
You identify as queer.
I do.
So many topics. And we'll also be talking about the fact that you were quite heavily bullied throughout your life, starting from as young as 5 to 6 years old in school.
Yeah.
And not actually stopping long after that.
No, and sometimes still from my family to this day.
And we're also going to talk about your accident that nearly changed the path of your career quite dramatically. And luckily you're with us here today.
Yeah.
Isn't that?
Very good.
So I think this is really an interview kind of similar to what we had with Veronica Lee in episode 8 and Yuri Sinatra episode 6 in our series 1. It's really a story about kind of struggles and then to triumph. So hopefully it'll be an inspiring interview for up-and-coming artists and fashion designers.
I really hope so.
Sure it will be. So let's talk about your background a little bit first. How did you get into designing clothes and design in general?
So it was something I kind of stumbled into, I suppose. I was always studying textiles at school and I was like, oh, I don't like this. I want to do wood tech. Like, textiles are too fiddly. And like, what is this fabric and pins and stuff? And then my beautiful sister, Iona, who's a manager in Hollywood, she at the time said no clothes fit her. And she was like, does nothing look right on her? She was like 16 and she was like, I just feel ugly in everything. And my dad left when I was 8, but he came back for a while when I was about 11, 12. And he drew me a croquis for my sister. And I was like, okay, I'll start designing. I'll design you some clothes because I love you and I want you to feel beautiful. So I started designing and just kind of fell in love with it and got obsessed with it. And then my sister showed me like Hussein Chalayan, Alexander McQueen, Vivienne Westwood. And I was just so blown away. I was like, fashion can be so much more than just clothing. It can be an escapism. It can be fantasy. It can be inspiring people. It can show you a whole different universe that we don't know about inside someone's mind. So, so I just started off designing when I was about, 10, 11. Yeah, that was great.
10, 11.
Yeah.
Very nice. So you said your dad left at 8.
Yes.
Do you want to give us a bit of a family background? Because it's quite interesting.
So my parents, my mum was a dancer and model in the 60s and 70s. So from an aristocratic background, was quite wealthy, but then left home to pursue acting and modelling and dancing at the age of 16. Did really well, was part of Legs & Co. back in the day. And then my dad is a refugee child from my grandmother who escaped the Russian working camps during the Second World War. Managed to escape after, horrible time in Poland.
How did she escape? Do you know?
Yes. So it was towards the end of the war. So they got grabbed by the Russians, taken into the forests, cutting down trees and just generally doing awful labour. And then towards the end of the war, they knew that they were basically going to lose. So they said the women could leave, but the men had to stay. Yeah. So the women decided to dress up the men as women. And yeah, my grandmother, bless her, escaping on trains to as far away as she could. But she lost her dad, my grandpa, on the train and she had to push him off. It was really hard for her, and she was like 16 and it was just really rough. She was an amazing woman. She was hilarious, absolutely hilarious. She was like, E.T. Hector, only the fat people survived in the concentration camps. I was like, oh my god, okay, grandma, oh my gosh. So she ended up in Zambia as a refugee. Wow. And she had a little fruit stand.
Okay.
Selling grapes and general fruits just outside the refugee camp. And then my Scottish grandfather came along and kept buying grapes every single day. And then they fell in love, and then they had a family in Zambia, and they loved it there so much. And then my dad lived there his entire life until he was 18. They moved to London to be an artist, and then met my mum, and they fell in love at first sight, apparently. Mm. Yeah.
Cute.
Which was really cute.
So you have being an artist in the genes.
So annoyingly. My mum's like, why didn't I make doctors and lawyers? And we're all artistic and so on.
Oh, that's funny. So there's four of you, right?
There are four of us, yeah.
Okay, and apparently your mother couldn't have children.
Yeah. So this wild thing, my mum was kind of a Buddhist.
Right.
For a long time, and I think had that kind of Buddhist mentality for a long time, and I think she brought us up with a little bit of that as well as kind of Christianity, but we weren't Christians until my mum and my dad tried a lot to have kids, and they couldn't. And they went to various doctors, and they were like, you can't have babies. We're really sorry. Like, you're infertile. And then, obviously devastated, then my mum met her friend, who was going to a prayer group, and she was like, oh, I'm pregnant. And she was like, wait, I thought we both couldn't have kids. And she was like, I got prayer and got it fixed. My mum was like, sorry, what?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what? So she was like, okay, let's give this a go. So she went to like a prayer group, got prayed for, and now there are four of us. So my oldest brother is called a miracle child. Because, yeah, completely miraculous. She went back to doctors and she was like, oh. And this was like 80s, maybe
crazy.
Late 70s, 80s. So they were just like...
So she went to a prayer group, they prayed for her.
Yeah, laid on hands, asked for the Holy Spirit, and yeah, she... Something worked. So she was like, okay, we're Christians now. Sorry, no Buddhism for us. Full on Christians. Let's go. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I guess you would be.
Yeah.
It's
kind of hard to go back. Yeah.
Wow, yeah. What a story. So you worked with the likes of Vivienne Westwood, Jonathan Saunders, J.W. Anderson. You went to Central St. Martin's. Tell us a bit about your experience.
Oh, gosh, varying different levels of trauma. It was fun. They were all different experiences. Vivienne Westwood was probably one of the most amazing because I was such an icon of her. She's been such an icon to me for so long, obviously. I remember screaming at her one day because I saw her down the... what's that one with all the lights in Chelsea? Chelsea Bridge or something. And she was on a bike and I was like, you go, Viv! And she literally looked at me like, so what the hell is wrong with this boy?
I met Simon Sinek like that in Mayfair and I did the same thing.
You didn't end up with
Simon.
So then I ended up working for her and I was like, oh my gosh, is she going to know? And that was so funny. And I applied to work for her and then at my interview went really well. And so funny because I'm so dyslexic.
Right.
And in the interview, they were like, so yeah, Why did you spell Vivienne Westwood incorrectly? And I was like,
Oh no.
I was like, I'm so sorry, I'm so dyslexic. And they were like, okay. And somehow I got it and it was great. But yeah. But it was wild. She'd come in, she'd be inspiring, she'd like look at like do fittings with us, show us like her shoe designs. We'd do embroidery, we'd be draping patterns, Helen Bonham Carter, Angelina Jolie would come in. Like, it was just really inspiring. We were right next to the, like, gold label, like, sewing rooms. So it was really incredible. And the weird thing about J.W. Anderson was he was in the flat below me.
Right.
So he was no one back then. I just lived in the flat above him with my dad. So one day, after finishing my foundation, I just knocked on the door and was like, hi, can I do an internship? And so worked for him for 6 months.
Wow.
And is now one of the biggest names in fashion, which is wild.
And you were also a fashion model for a while.
I was, believe it or not.
It must be, like, super hard to get into that.
So I was asked to do a couple of photo shoots by friends at Central Martins. People were like, come model for me. So I got to know photographers and stuff. And then some agencies kind of approached me and were like, do you want to be a model? And I was like, sure.
No.
This sounds fun. Let's crack on with this. So started testing, got into modeling, was really fun, really intense, because I'm like just 6 foot.
Right,
so it's
okay.
The short end. So everyone's a lot taller than me. And like, it's weird. It's weird to see, like, you're insecure when you see a lot of pretty people. When your job is to go into a room surrounded by people who are 99% prettier than you, taller than you, more rugged than you are, more ripped you are than you, you're like, this is a way to be insecure. Wow. But it was fun. And it was a great back way into the fashion industry, and you know, makeup artists, hairstylists, and...
That's true.
Yeah.
Have you seen... I don't know what his name is, but he's this kind of ginger-haired kid who's now like, he's a model for like the most massive brands. And he was like heavily bullied as a kid. Anyway, he's living his life. And he does videos like, oh, you guys who bullied me, look at me now. He's like on the catwalks and all the rest. But he's such a sweet kid as well. But it's just kind of, you know, you can do anything. Even
the model with the cut. Yeah, and he just like really close up TikToks.
Yeah.
He's amazing. He's really sweet. No, it's true. It's why I run this model scouting agency as well, because it changed my life. It really did, in positive and negative ways. But it made me believe myself and see myself differently and step out in confidence and just be like, oh, I'm somewhat okay looking. This is new. This is great. This is nice. And just great to travel and see people and meet new people. And yeah, it was just really fun.
The fashion world can be notorious for, maybe some dodgy stuff. I don't know, inappropriate stuff.
Yeah.
Did anything happen to you that perhaps you would have liked not to go through that?
It was like, teens, 20s, early 20s. I think, I caution all my models now, and I'm always like, if you ever have anything, just call me immediately. If you ever feel uncomfortable, just give me a ring. Like, any day, night, any country you're in, just tell me. Just tell everyone. And the thing is, now it's different with social media. You can really be like, I had a really uncomfortable time. Mm. Like, I think people are more scared about doing stuff.
Right.
But back in my day, there wasn't that opportunity. And I'd had photographers ask me to take off all my clothing. I'd had people in fittings, like, touch me up while putting on trousers, like, put their face across my groin and just... It was disgusting, like some really disgusting stuff, some disgusting things said, and just put in really uncomfortable circumstances. And I do feel it's different now, but I wish I'd had the courage and self-belief to just say no.
It's quite difficult, right? To say no, or...
Yeah.
I'm sure it is.
Yeah, I guess it was some of the things I was saying as well. They're like, you're going to be really big in America. Like, I so see that for you. And I was like, it's awful. And I remember crying at the bus stop after it kind of initially happened for the first time. And I was just like, But I think it's a different time. And I think the Me Too movement has heavily changed that as well.
Okay.
People are willing to step out. And I actually recently had the courage to tell my agents about one circumstances with an editor of a magazine. And I was like, don't ever send any of my models to that director, because,
I love that. I love that kind of cleaning up and that.
They have each other as well. I try and link them all so they have support networks and like mentors within the same modeling agencies.
I think it's easier to say no when you have that. If you have no one kind of backing you, it's hard to say no. But if you know that you can actually call someone, it's okay, then it's a little bit easier. Okay, so you were... catwalk model. Something happened to you. Now we're going into
Yes. I wonder what it was.
So you're leaning against the wall or against the shafts of lifts.
Yes. So I was having a cigarette outside.
Is this like a no smoking commercial, basically?
Genuinely, don't never smoke, especially near walls or lift shafts. I left my friend's house in the morning, and I was having a cigarette, morning cigarette, obviously, and leant back on these double doors that were like shutter doors, and the lock had been broken the day before, so the shutter doors opened behind me, and I'd just fallen three stories backwards.
Backwards.
And the only thing that protected my pelvis was my backpack, and then both my legs hit the ground, both snapped. And this one, that's where the bone broke out the back. And then almost lost my right leg. Was kind of, properly disabled for a while and was in a wheelchair for a long time. And it wasn't great. And I was down there for like half an hour, because the shutter door was closed behind me.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah. No one could hear me screaming, which is hilarious. I screamed for help, and like I didn't know it was that bad. I kept trying to just stand up, and I was like, "Why can't I get up?"
All right.
And then my friend Dan, he found me, and he opened. I was like, "Dan!" And he opened the doors, and he was like, "What are you doing down there, you stupid That's my word. And I was like, Dad, help me. I can't move my legs. Look down, because it was pitch black.
Right,
the door was closed.
Sure.
I looked down, there was just the biggest pool of blood. And he was like, oh my gosh. And I was like, oh my gosh. So he managed to flag down an ambulance and he was so lucky. He was like, I was like so close to losing my legs. And when I woke up from the hospital in the Royal London, thank you, Dr. Barry, Mr. Barry. And they were like, you still might lose your right leg. You lost all your severed artery. We managed to patch it up as quickly as we could. So they managed to save both my legs and I'm still walking a lot. It was traumatic and interesting. It was weird to be 23 learning to use your legs again. But
how long was the physio or the recovery afterwards?
It was a proper like 6 months of just wheelchairing and then like just learning to walk. It's just so embarrassing. I kept fainting because it was just, there was just so much to sort out, I guess. I've had some physio and lots of bio oil. So we're getting there.
Bio oil is not there. Let's go back a little bit to Christianity.
Mm.
So you identify as queer.
I do.
Which probably was difficult to tell your family, I guess. It probably always is.
Yeah.
Do you want to walk us through that a little bit?
Sure. Yeah. It's a funny battle, being queer and being Christian.
Are you very religious?
I would say I'm pretty uber religious.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I'd say I've always loved Jesus and Jesus is the center of my life.
Okay.
And I was kind of always like that, but I was always artistic and weird. And it's that stage where you were bullied in school for being like, oh my gosh, you're like queer, you're different, you're strange. And people could see it in me before I saw it in myself. And so when I figured it out for myself, I was like, maybe the bullies, everything they said about me was right. Mm. Maybe I am a freak, maybe I am a loser, maybe I don't deserve to live. And all these things you kind of completely take on because you're like, damn, they were right about this one thing that I so reject and so pushed against. But my journey with God, it's been amazing. It's just nothing but love. Like, as I said, like, Jesus was hung out with, like, prostitutes and the equivalent of drug dealers. So I'm like, he was pretty...
What's the problem?
Yeah, I was like, he was a legend. Like, I was like, he was from the dodgy ends and he was, like, wild. And he was a geezer. And, like, everyone's like, Jerusalem? Like, who are you? Like, that's, like, I don't know, Croydon. The equivalent. And everyone's like...
YouTube channel.
Yeah. And it was just cool and just said love and just don't hate and don't judge, which is so funny that the Christian church is so judgmental.
Mm.
It was like, we're meant to be loving each other and like looking after everyone and everyone is our brother and everyone's our sister. And the fact is, he didn't say anything about it.
Yeah.
And like so much of the Old Testament, we don't listen to like wearing cotton and various other things, but he didn't say anything about it. And if Jesus didn't say anything about it, I'm a Christian and I follow Christ, so... If he didn't say anything about it, I'm cool.
But he did get sent to conversion therapy, which I cannot believe still exists. That is just bizarre.
Yeah.
So tell us about conversion therapy and what happens there.
It was intense. I think when you feel so much shame and guilt and listening to the bullies...
How old were you, believe?
Oh, gosh. I think I must have been... When I properly started, I must have been 18, 19. But just leaving home and you're like, who am I becoming? I'm going to university. I'm meeting all these friends. Like... discovering who you are, really.
So who sent you there? Your parents? Your mother?
Kind of a semi-combination.
Okay.
I think they did it out of love, out of... Because I think in time I was saying, like, I don't know where I am, I'm confused. And I think this was their attempt to help. And I know they love me. And we've come to terms with it now. But at the time, it was really hard. It was really hard. Because... when you feel disgusting and when you feel like you're a freak and you feel like the person you love most in the world hates you and everyone who you've grown up with in the church hates you too, it makes you hate yourself. And that's really hard. But that's life, I guess. You sit in a one-to-one and they kind of pray over you and they do the kind of like psychological breakdown of you. As well as quite a lot of preaching on you and like intense prayer and stuff. But the problem is I'd walk away and I'd often sit at a bench and cry, this is horrible and I feel awful about myself. And yeah, I stopped and I'm glad I did. And I think it's a funny thing. Queerness can't define who you are.
Yeah.
Well, it's just a part of you, though. And I'm so proud of my little queer family. And, like, finding yourself and finding who you are, it's undeniable that queerness, it's a part of you a little bit.
Mm.
Like, loving Italian food. it's... I think you can see it, and you can almost spell it on someone when someone's queer.
Yeah.
People are like, so, you a girl, boy, player, person, queer? And I think it just reflects off you sometimes.
Okay.
And I think it shouldn't define who you are, but I think it's a small, beautiful part of you that you shouldn't be ashamed of.
But I guess it's hard to realise it in yourself because it's not, like, mainstream, I guess, like most of your classmates.
Yeah.
So I think that probably makes it a bit more difficult.
True. And queer bashing still happens quite regularly, even in the UK. Yeah, anyway. Yesterday, someone screamed at their car, like, you need to get a new vest, love! And I was like, you love it, babe! And he was like, no, I don't. Yeah, people are scared of difference in any kind of capacity.
Yeah,
if anyone's different, anyone looks different, any kind of race, ethnicity, background, minority, people are scared of difference.
Mm.
And it's just fear. And it's just not understanding.
Tell us about the bullying that you went through. So the bullying started at 5 or 6 years old.
Yeah.
So when you entered school, I guess.
More or less, yes. I had my arch nemesis in primary school. And it got quite physical and, like, smashed the back of my head in. Well, not in, but smashed it quite badly that I got a huge scar on the back of my head. And I was like six.
What?
6, 7. Because people knew I was different and a weirdo.
I mean, fine, okay.
Yeah.
But what did the school... True. What did the school do about it? Like, nothing? Or...
I think...
You have a child now who's cracked his head in school because of bullying.
Yeah, because he shoved me into the table legs.
Right.
And people things.
Right.
I don't think they knew how to. I think at that age, physical violence is quite... Maybe rare? Well, maybe it's not rare. Like, I don't know, man. So I guess... He probably told off his parents, but, like, he just carried on and continued right into secondary school as well. And then it got more physically violent. Like, on a school trip, one of the bullies, I was year 7, so I was, like, 11. And this guy got this biro and stabbed me in the arm, like, 40 times. And I had blood pouring through this arm, through my shirt and my jumper. So it was visible on the outside of my jumper. And it was every day. And it was physical and it was verbal and it was... It was awful. Yeah. But what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, and bullies have no power over you. And I think for a long time I was like, I have to prove these people that I'm not what they said I was.
Mm-hmm.
Or I have to say that I have to prove wrong and be stronger and be more successful. And then you get to a stage where you're like, I need to do this for me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they don't deserve any more of my time.
So kind of where was the turnaround that... You know, made you, like, love yourself again, which you do, and, kind of like a success story.
Therapy definitely helped, and it was, learn to love myself, and just realising all the weirdness and all the, like, funny quirkiness of me is acceptable and lovable, and that I deserve to love myself.
So how did you come to that?
How did I come to that? Once again, going on therapy.
Okay.
But I think self-reflection, self-understanding, realization, there's that whole exercise you do with the mirror and you have to look at yourself and really, like, just stare at yourself. I had to be like, I have to be okay with what I look like.
Yeah.
I have to be okay with this person that I am. Because I can't escape me. I can't run away. I have to just love this crazy being that I am and just love all the things, all the mistakes I've made and all the, like, things I've gone through and all the trauma and just be like, you know what? This doesn't define you.
Yeah.
None of the pain defines you. None of the bullying defines who you are. You are stronger and you are wiser and you are more beautiful. Even through going through these things, all the best artists go through struggle. And it's made me stronger and wiser and more passionate about fighting for people who are repressed and standing up. Because some people don't understand.
Yeah.
Some people, someone will fight someone in the tube and they'll not step in. And you're like, no, get the hell away from them. Like, don't you do that. Like... This isn't okay, and some people just don't understand that people have been oppressed. So I think compassion, understanding, self-love, being able to love other people, and just all-around goodness.
Tell us where you are today.
things are going really well. So I just last month appeared in Polish Vogue, nice. In their print and also their video media. I've just appeared in this issue of Wonderland as well as last issue. I'm in 5.11 magazine this month as well. I've had requests from Elle, Harper's Bazaar, Tatler, Korean Vogue, British Vogue. Things are going really well. Like celebrities like Becky Hill have pulled stuff. Griff, I just the beautiful, amazing Griff for her tour. Who else? Just, it's been such a whirlwind of just fun people and trying to dress people for the Oscars, which have been going well. They went really well. And just, yeah, it's been a busy whirlwind of just success. This show that I did on a whim, made from recycled fabrics, trying to be environmentally friendly as well as, yeah, just trying to put a positive view of how we recycle fabric. And it's suddenly gone really well and it's been pulled and I'm getting interviews and I'm being featured in Forbes. Nice. And Condé Nast.
Fashion Week is coming up.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that. And so, am I invited?
Yes, of course you are. Please come. I will dress you. My fashion show is on the 15th of September.
Nice.
It's titled Into the Gloaming, which is based on Christina Rossetti's poem of Goblin Market. Okay. I've slightly changed it a little bit from the poem, but these two girls wander off into the forest and they eat fruits of the forest. So it's also like that, the Hades daughter, Greek mythology, where it's cool, she has some fruit and she has to stay in hell and some, anyway. So these girls wander in the forest, eat the fruits, and they slowly become the monsters, beasts, and bugs of the forest.
Right.
It'll go from like very placid to very colourful to very dark, and that's kind of the ethos that it's going into the gloaming, and who will you become when you come out? And that idea of transformation, which I guess is also reflected in me. So yeah,
you should have your grandmother's fruit stall there in the corner.
Oh, I would love that. That would be beautiful.
You'll
have the Oscar's fruit stall. Yes, that's beautiful, actually. That would be really cool.
I love your story. I think it's really good that you've persevered through and that you've kind of found yourself and that you're doing really well. Do you have a takeaway, perhaps, for the up-and-coming maybe designers or models or just maybe someone who's struggling in life and doesn't know how to, can't find a way out?
Yeah, it's. I guess for all of us, I think gratefulness. When I was going through really depressive episodes, gratefulness, just being thankful for what we have. It's so hard when everything's so dark.
Mm.
But really being like, I'm so thankful for all this beauty I have around me, for this opportunity of this life. It's a split second.
It is true.
And just, I have to see the beauty in it, because the bad times will go. They might be long, but they will disappear eventually. And yeah, stick it out and make the most of this life. And even wanting to be in fashion or any modeling or anything, it's about you at the end. This is your life.
Mm.
And we can have dreams and they can be really big, but it's actually at the end of the day, what do you want to do with your life? How do you want to spend this moment?
Mm.
Do you want to spend it slugging away in a sewing machine, getting ready for London Fashion Week endlessly? Some people it's made for, and it's horrible. But some people, yeah, it's finding what you really, really actually love and how you want to spend these moments. And that's the important thing for this life that we lead.
So never give up.
Never give up. Keep going. Follow your dreams, but also know what you really want.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Hector Maclean.
Thank you so much, gorgeous. That's been amazing. Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome.
Let's go, girl.